dear students, welcome back to the virtual class. So today I am going to teach you a new chapter from civics, that is directive principles of state policy. Directive principles of state policy. Okay, so this directive principles of state policy is mentioned down in part 4 of our constitution. So in the previous classes we discussed about part 3, right? We discussed about part 4a also. Part 3 deals with fundamental rights and part 4a deals with the fundamental duties. So in the previous class I have already taught you, and those who have missed that those videos, please do watch it. It is there in the description box. I have shared the link over there. Please do watch it. So, and one more request, watch this tutorial till the last, okay? Watch this tutorial till the last. It is for your benefit. So, what is mean by directive principles of state policy? What is mean by directive principles of state policy? So, in the directive principles, in part 4 of our constitution, part 4 of our constitution, this part contains a set of principles which are to guide the future policies of the Indian state. The future policies of the Indian states are guided in this part. What should a government do? What type of policies should be brought for the country, either by a state government or a central government, is mentioned over there. It's like a guide. Okay, so in a very simple word, if I am asked to tell you what is mean by directive principles of state policy, I may tell in my own words, directive principles of state policies are the guidelines to be followed by the central government or the state government, okay, while making policies. Whenever they make any policies, they are to be guided by that principle. So what should be the priority? What should I do for the state? Okay, what should be done in order to develop the country? So all the guidelines are given over there in directive principles of state policy. So today in this class I am going to teach you all the guidelines one by one. What should be the priority of the government? Okay, so whenever a government make any policy, whenever a government new government comes to power, it is their duty to frame such a policy which could help the state to become a welfare state. What is mean by welfare state? A state in which all the facilities are provided. Now you see, we have 29 states in our country, but all the states are different. All the states' economic development are different. Geographical, I'm not talking about geographical condition, but the government are elected by the people, but the government is not working for the development of the state. Still people suffers a lot. They don't get the basic amenities. Why it is so? Because they don't take the directive principles seriously. If all the states of our country is following, if they follow the directive principles strictly in their policy, then definitely there won't be any inequality in the state. It's an every state will be equal. Okay? In terms of education, in terms of livelihood, in terms of economic development, in terms of social development, if all these are included in their policy, then definitely there won't be any problem. So you can see many states, there are differences in state. Whereas Maharashtra, okay, Maharashtra and Gujarat, Calcutta, all these are developed state, all the facilities are there. That is why many of the people, they go there in search of jobs. Whereas people of other states, they don't get employment facility. That is why they go in other state to work for sustaining their life. Why it is so? So government should take care of the guidelines to be followed in the in their policy. Whenever a policy is made, they must focus. What should I do? What should be my priority? So I don't know anything. Just forget it. Just follow the guidelines. Just go through the part 4 of the constitution. What all are mentioned over there? What should be my focus? So accordingly, I'll include in my policy. So this part contains a set of principles which are to guide the future policies of the Indian state. Indian state future policies are guided. Okay, so what is the aim What is the aim of directive principles of state policy? The most important aim of directive principles of state policy is to secure social and economic justice and to promote welfare of all the citizens of India. Welfare of all the citizens of India. Okay, each and every people living in a state should get all the civic facilities and whereas other facilities, and that is the duty of the state government to provide them. Okay, education they need, the water they need, employment they need, schooling they need, hospital and dispensaries they need. Apart from this, many are there. All this we are going to discuss today in this class. Now let me tell you just one more thing. Fundamental rights are for the people of the country. If any of the fundamental rights of the citizens are infringed or taken away, then definitely they can move to the court, right? They can move to the court. But if the state government is not following the directive principles, can the state be dragged into the court? Not possible, maybe. Okay? So it is mentioned directive principles are not legally binding. Not legally binding. That is why you see some states they follow, some states they don't follow, and there is no one to question them. We cannot file a case against the state government if they are not doing so, if they are not following the guidelines of the directive principles and state policy. So, directive principles are not enforceable by the courts. It cannot be enforced by the courts. This is just a basic difference in fundamental duties, fundamental rights and the directive principles of state policy. Did you understand? Now, one more thing we need to understand, my dear. Directive principles, from where did the idea came into the minds of the framer? The directive principles should be included in our constitution. So the framers of our constitution, they were very much inspired by the constitution of Ireland. So we can say that directive principles of state policy is borrowed from the Irish constitution, the constitution of Ireland. We have borrowed from them. Definitely, whenever we like anything good, we can borrow them. We learn from the people only, from the countries only. So we liked it. The framers of our constitution, they were very much inspired by the Irish constitution regarding the directive principle. That is why they borrowed it and they included in our constitution. So one more time, directive principles of state policy is written in part 4 of our constitution. So now, what are the guidelines? We are going to discuss it one by one, so please listen to it carefully. Don't skip the video. Just watch the video till the end. It is for you only. Okay, now first one we have is socialist welfare directive principles or socio-economic principles. Okay, so what is mentioned over here? First one, the state, it is the duty of the state. State should secure the welfare of the people by securing social, economic and political justice. What type of justice should be secured by the state government? Social justice, economic justice and political justice. Okay, next one, states should provide, these are the guidelines, states should do, they must, it is mentioned over there what states should do. So it is to be done by the state. States should provide adequate means of livelihood to all the citizens. Each and every people of the state must get adequate means of livelihood. Food, clothing and shelter. Livelihood means roti, kapda, makan. That is food, clothing and shelter must be provided. Right? So each and every people, the educated youth should get jobs. Right? Those who are not educated, they also must be given, provided jobs in different sectors. Got it? So that they can lead their life peacefully. At least three things everybody requires. Food we require, clothing we require, okay, and shelter, home we require. So that is the duty of the state government to provide adequate means of livelihood to all the citizens. Okay, next one we have is the state should try to secure equitable distribution of material resources and promote common good. Equitable distribution of wealth. The wealth of the country should be equally distributed. The provision must be made in such a way that the wealth can reach to the needy people so that they can lead their life in a proper way. Okay, it should be for the common good. It should be for the benefit of each and every people, not only rich people or not only the poor people. I'm not telling you to neglect any of the groups. It should be the wealth of the country must be utilized for the equitable distribution of material, that means for the promotion of common good for everyone. The next one, the state should prevent the concentration of wealth and the means of production in few hands. Very, very important. It is the duty of the state government to prevent the concentration of wealth into the hands of few people. If it is not done, my dear, what will happen? Rich will become richer and richer, and poor will become poorer and poorer. And the means of production also should not be in the hands of few people. Means of production means, economic students, you know it. What is mean by means of production? Land, labor, capital and organization. So it should be controlled by the state government. Or I'm not saying that only state government, not only to few, must be given to every people so that they can lead their life properly and they can generate employment for other people also. So very, very simple. Wealth should not be concentrated, and this is the duty of the state government to look. This is the duty of the state government to prevent the concentration of wealth in the hands of few people or few hands. Then most importantly, it is the duty of the state government, my dear, to provide equal pay for equal work to both men and women. Okay, for both men and women. So state government must ensure that equal pay must be given for both men and women. There should not be any difference. Oh, this is man, so he must get 400 rupees, and this is female, she must get 300 rupees. No, equal pay for equal work. If he or she, if suppose a lady, if a male is also doing the same work and the female is also doing the same work, so payment must be equal. We should not make a differences that he or she is male or female. So equal pay for equal work, that should be ensured by the state government. Okay, the next one, states should protect the health and strength of workers, men and women. Strength of workers, that is men and women, their health must be protected by them. So for that, what has to be done? Hospitals should be set up, dispensaries should be set up so that their health can be taken care by those departments. So it is the duty of the state to protect the health of the workers, whether it is men or women. Okay, then states should protect the children from doing harmful work. States should protect the children from doing harmful work. The next one, states should protect children and youth from exploitation. Children and youth should be protected from being exploited. If a small children, in spite of going to school, if they are sent to work in factories, that is exploitation. It is a duty of the state government to prevent that and send them to the proper place where they should be. So it is their lookout. Okay. States should try to secure right to work and education. The right to work must be secured, and education also must be secured. Education. That means it is the duty of the state government to secure right to work. Every workers, their work should be secured. Education for the children should be secured. How? The state must come up with certain policies so that each and every children must go to school, should be sent to school, and all the cost of all the expenses of the children should be beared by the state government. Okay, then it should be the duty of the state government to give public assistance in case of unemployment. If a person or any other person is unemployed, there is no unemployment, then it is the duty of the state government to give them employment. give them job. If they don't have employment, if they don't have job, they'll die without food, my dear. So that is not wise, my dear. So it is the duty of the state government. Look out. Look who all are unemployed. That is why employment exchanges are opened in all the districts, my dear, where the people, after getting education, they enroll their names in the employment exchange. So whenever there is any vacancies, they are informed. They go give the interviews and all, write the exams and all. Not only that, many other schemes are opened by state government to engage the people so that they can at least earn their livelihood. It is also the duty of the state government to look after the old age people. What to do? Many of the old people, though they don't have their children, or many of their children have thrown them out of their houses. Who is there to look after them? Who will take care of them? So old age homes are there. Old age homes are there where old people, those who have no one to look after them, they go there, they stay there, they live their remaining life. They live their remaining life over there. So they are also to be looked after by the central government or the state government. Old people, old age, sickness and disablement, many are disabled. There is no one to look after them, no one to take care of them, the state government or the central government. Okay, the state government, if I'm talking about state government, it doesn't mean only the state, particular state. We can take India as a whole. You understand? So it is the duty of the, suppose like a, like your parent who is responsible to look after the family, to look after each and every problems to be sorted out. It is also the duty of the state government to act like a guardian of the people of the state. Okay. So, next one, states should try to secure healthy conditions of work for workers. The workers, wherever they work, must be given good working conditions. The environment, the working environment must be healthy. So it is not the matter of one day that today I am going to work, from tomorrow I will not work. No, you have to work every day. So the environment, working environment should be healthy, so that your health can be taken care of. So many factories are there, they force the workers to work day and night without giving them proper wages, with proper facilities, and once they fall sick, then definitely there is no one to look after them. It should not be. Health should be taken care of. That is why we say, no, health is wealth. If your health is okay, you can earn lots of wealth. So you must give priority to your health. So it is the duty of the state to secure healthy condition of workers for the worker. So this is all about socio-economic directive principles. So all these are, so whatever I told you right now are mentioned there in the directive principles of state policy. So it is the duty of the state government to look one by one, what all things are not included in my policy, so I must include it. I must give priority to the directive principle so that we can have a welfare state. Okay, the next one, next principle is Gandhian principles. Gandhian directive principles or Gandhian principles. So, you know that Gandhiji always wanted to protect cottage industries and all. He always wanted to end up untouchability. He wanted to provide employment to the people, right? He wanted to promote cottage industry. So that was his ideals. That is why Gandhiji's ideals were also included in the directive principle of state policy under the heading Gandhian principles. So number one, states should organize village panchayats and give them adequate powers. Village panchayats should be there and the panchayat should be given adequate powers. You know that we in West Bengal, you see the place where we live is a panchayat area, and the administration of this area is looked after by the panchayat. Panchayati system should be there so that the grassroots level can be taken care by the panchayats. If there is a problem, if there arises any problem right now in our place, I'm not going to wait for the state government or central government to provide us relief. Our panchayat is there, they will be the one to come and solve our problem. So at the local level, at the grassroots level, our problems can be sorted by ourselves only. So So who are these panchayat members? We are the one who have elected them and we have given them powers to look after the administration. So Gandhiji always wanted to organize village panchayat and adequate powers must be given to the village panchayats. Okay, the next one, cottage industries should be promoted in rural areas. Very important one. Cottage industries should be promoted in rural areas so that they can generate their livelihood. They can be employed. Unemployment problem will be sorted out by providing them cottage industries. How much jobs will be provided by the state government, central government? Lakhs and lakhs, lakhs and lakhs of people every year they get graduated, they get all the degrees, they don't get jobs. From where will they get the jobs? Many are unemployed. So, if at the grassroots level, at the village level, if the people of the villages are promoted with the cottage industries, providing all sort of help to grow cottage industries, that will solve the unemployment problem. So, that was the idea of Gandhiji. That is why this was included in directive principles of state policy. Okay. Next one, educational and economic interests of the weaker section of the society should be specially protected. The weaker section of the society's special interest must be protected by the state government. Who are the weaker sections? The ST and SCs. They are the weaker sections of the society. The tribal people, they are the weaker sections of the society. Their involvement must be included. They should not be neglected by throwing them out from our mainstream of the country. They must be given education, they must be pulled forward, they must be given all sort of facilities. So it should be the duty of the state government, my dear, to look after the weaker section of the society by looking after the economic interest. Whether they get jobs or not, whether they have enough for livelihood or not, that must be looked after by the state government. That is why you see many of the seats everywhere are reserved. In educational institutions, states are seats are reserved. Why? So that this weaker section, they can come forward and they can also feel that we are not neglected. Okay? So, if you want to make the equality successful, right to equality successful, then these people who are left out, they also must be brought to the mainstream and make them feel that we all are one. They must not feel that we are discriminated, we are left out. No. State government should bring them forward and must protect their economic interest. The next one, state should secure prohibition in society. Secure prohibition in society. Social prohibition should not be there. Society must be taken due care by the state even. No one should be neglected. Okay. The next one, state should take steps for developing or for the development of agriculture, animal husbandry. Okay. It should be the duty of the state government to take steps to promote agriculture. For agriculture, irrigation should be provided. Banks should be opened up which can give credit facilities to the farmers. Okay. Animal husbandry should be set up so that animals should be taken care by the animal husbandry. Doctors are there. If cow or buffalo suffers from fever, where they will go? Who will treat them? For them also doctors are there. For the farmers, cattle are very, very important. So, like human beings, cattle are also to be treated. So, they are also treated like a human being. They are also given injections, they are given tablets, they are given saline waters and all. So, animal husbandry should be look after. That means there must be given importance. Doctors should be appointed. Compounders should be appointed so that they can go from village to village wherever animal cattle are there. Time to time checkups can be done. That way they can know the health of the animals. Because cow is also important. Buffalo is also important. Ox is also important. Because they are the one. They are the source of food as well as help for the farmers. Did you understand, my dear? The next one, steps for preserving and improving the breeds of animals, okay, should be undertaken by the state. State That means states should take steps for preserving and improving the breeds of animals. That is their duty. Breed of animals. Okay. The next one, very important. As for the directive principle, it is mentioned like slaughter of cows and calves and other cattle should be banned. Slaughter of cows and calves should be banned. So now you see here, if the state government, if they decide that from now onward we are not going to permit any of the people to slaughter cows or calves, then they can do it. People cannot go against it because they are following the directive principles. They are not going against the constitution. They can do it. If they follow any of the guidelines mentioned in the directive principle, they can do it. They have the right. That is for the state government only. That is for the state government only. One more is mentioned over there, state government should take care of the health of the youths. They should prohibit the sale of intoxicating drinks and drugs. Drinks and drugs should be banned. They can do it. Like the example I can give you from Bihar. The Bihar government has banned the sale of liquor. They have banned the sale of liquor. Now liquors selling and purchasing is illegal. If anybody is caught selling liquor, they will be fined, they will be put into the jail. So many black marketing goes on, but once they are caught, they will be punished also and they will be sent to the jail also. It is illegal now that they have made it compulsory that no sale of liquors. Whichever is harmful, whichever is intoxicating, intoxicating drinks like many other liquids, let us say liquor and all, very, very harmful. It's injurious for our health. So if the state government has taken decision to ban it, nobody can question them. No one can question them. You understand? State Bihar government has done it. So this way, if all the state government does, then okay, no problem. Why not? It's possible. Did you understand, children, what I'm trying to say? So these all are Gandhian principles. So that is included in directive principles of state policy. Now next one we have is general principle. It is the duty of the state government. It is mentioned in general principle. It is mentioned one by one. It should be the duty of the state government to secure uniform civil code in India. Everywhere uniform civil code, one law, one code should be followed everywhere. So recently certain bills were introduced which were people thought that were against their religion. It's not that. It is given in the directive principle. Uniform civil code. The code of law should be equal for everyone. You understand? Then most important is, my dear, free and compulsory education should be given to all children up to the age of 14. Free. But now that has been made very, very important and it's been shifted to fundamental rights. We discussed last time. Through the Education Act, through the Right to Education Act 2002, this right to education for the children below the age of 14 has been made it compulsory through fundamental rights. And even in duty also, fundamental duty also, point number 11, it is the duty of every parent or guardian to send the children to school. Compulsory. So before it was there in directive principle, nobody bothered, everybody ignored it, nobody took it seriously. That is why now it has been made fundamental right. So now every child below the age of 14, they will be given free and compulsory education. Right to Education Act 2002. A long list of acts is there. All things are written over there. The next one is judiciary should be made separate from executive. Judiciary should be kept independent. They must be separated from executive. There should not be any interference in judiciary by the executive. The next one, free legal aid to poor should be given. Any of the poor people, if they want any help, legal aid, like suppose they have been working, sorry, let me tell you, like a person is poor and he or she cannot hire a lawyer to defend himself or herself, then what to do? Legal help must be provided. Legal help will be given by the government. That only will promote equality of law. Okay, equality of law. Law is equal for everyone. All legal help will be given to them. The next one, it is the duty of the state government to protect and improve the environment. Protect and improve the environment. Okay, the next one, to safeguard the forest and wildlife, to protect historical monuments. Okay, to promote international peace and security, to maintain good relation with other countries, to respect international law and treaty obligations. Okay, so all this. So my dear, state is expected to secure all these directive principles by making and implementing suitable policies and decisions. How? By making and implementing suitable policies and decisions. They can do if they want to. If there is a willingness to follow the directive principles, then definitely, my dear, it will bring lots and lots of changes. So it is the duty of the state government to follow. But if they don't follow, what can be done? We cannot drag them to the court. It is not enforceable by courts. Did you understand? Hope you all have understood it. So now let me tell you, what is the importance of dietary principles? So very simple, dietary principles are backed by public opinion. It is the opinion of people. That is why all the time, whenever any changes are to be brought in the policy, then the public opinion is taken due care. Okay. Next one, dietary principles is provided for the welfare of the state. It looks for the it looks after the welfare of the people. It also is important for the moral ideals. Then dietary principle constitute a guide for the state. It is a guide for the state. I don't know anything what to do. I am in the government. I am now going to make a policy. I am a new person in the government. What to do? Nothing. No need to worry. I'll take out dietary principle, state policy. What is to be done? What should be the parity? What should be the policy? What should be the policy which I must include in my policies? So definitely, my dear, this is all about dietary principle. So many of the states they follow, many of the states they don't. But that is why there is a differences in all the states. You see the states like Punjab and all, industries are not there. Agriculture is there. Most of the people, they are involved in agriculture. You can see agriculture is done in such a way, my dear, they give importance to agriculture. That is why people of Punjab, they are so rich. Whereas other states, which we call them as agricultural state, but still people, what they do? They leave that and they go to metropolitan cities in search of jobs. So if government takes care of the agriculture, my dear, if they promote agriculture in a proper way by providing irrigation facilities, by providing them cheap credit facilities, then definitely they will do it. And the prices of agricultural items are given properly. If it is fixed by the government timely in a proper way, then there is no problem. So, my dear, everything has to be done by the government. Okay. So, all these things are there. Dietary principles, state policies are mentioned down. So, do you think that any of the dietary principles are implemented till now? Have been put into practice till now? Many are there. Like, for example, laws have been passed for elimination of zamindari system. Zamindari system has been eliminated so that right of the land must be given to the peasants and the farmers. Many other land reforms have been introduced. Panchayat Raj systems are there in almost all the states. Many reforms are brought within the Panchayati Raj system. Then state has taken steps to provide educational and health facilities to the persons belonging to the weaker section of society. Reservations of seats in educational institutions for persons belonging to scheduled caste, scheduled tribe and other backward classes has been done. It has been done. So many of the acts has been enacted, my dear, for the interest of the women, like Dowry Prohibition Act 1961, right? Then suppression of immoral traffic in women and girls, Sita, has been functioning since 1956. Okay, so many are there. Provision of equal wages for equal work for both men and women has been given in legal foundation. That is also been given in many of the states. So, all the guiding principles are implemented by many of the states, many of the state government as well as the central government. So, long list is there. Okay. Then even minimum wages have been fixed. Health and accident benefits have been granted to the workers. They have been granted facilities. Okay. So, in order to promote a cottage industry, several boards have been set up for the promotion of cottage industries, like All India Khadi and Village Industries Board, Small Scale Industries Board, Silk Board, All India Handicraft Board, All India Handloom Board. So, all these boards are set up to promote cottage industries. State, many of the state also has taken several steps for developing agriculture and animal husbandry. Okay. Then several states have introduced free education for children belonging to weaker section of the society. Evil practices like a beggar and bonded labor have been abolished by the law. Okay. And state has enacted laws for protecting historical monuments and other objects of historical significance. Laws have been enacted for pollution control and protection of environment. That's been done. What I'm trying to say is that implementation has been done. Whatever is there in the guiding principles is not only there in the book or in the constitution, that has come out from that in the form of implementation. Many of the state government has implemented it. Okay. Recently, that I have already discussed many times, education of children has been made for ensuring the fundamental rights. That means, I told you, it has been taken off from fundamental duty, dietary principle, and has been included in fundamental rights, so that children below the age of 14, they can get free and compulsory education. Okay, my dear children. So, despite all these efforts state governments are trying to do, despite all these efforts, my dear, state has not been fully successful in implementing the directive principles. All this implementation is there, but they have not been successful in implementing all the directive principles properly. So, what is needed? There is a big need to expand and strengthen efforts for securing the full implementation of all dietary principles contained in part 4 of our constitution. Efforts are needed. It's going on. So this is all about dietary principles of state policy implementation. Okay. So in which part dietary principle is mentioned? Dietary principle is mentioned in part which part? Tell me. It is mentioned in part 4 of our constitution. Okay. And fundamental right is included in part 3 of our constitution. Did you understand? So, all this, my dear, if the state government follows it strictly, then definitely the state, each and every state, will definitely become a welfare state. So, what is mean by welfare state? The state in which all the facilities are provided. While discussing the salient features of the Indian constitution, I discuss about the welfare state also. Okay. Now let us make a differences between fundamental right and directive principles of state policy. Fundamental right and directive principles of state policy. Okay. So it is very, very important to understand. Okay, so here you can have it. I have made a differences between fundamental right and dietary principles. So, fundamental rights are provided in part 3 of our constitution, whereas dietary principles are provided in part 4 of our constitution. Okay, then second one, fundamental rights are justiciable, whereas dietary principles are not justiciable. That means if any of the fundamental rights are infringed, we can move to the court, whereas dietary principles, if that is not implemented by the state government, we cannot drag the state to the court. Then fundamental rights are privileges for the citizens to enjoy, that is a privilege for every citizens to enjoy, whereas dietary principles are to be used by the government to create privilege for the citizens. Okay, it is to be used by the government to create privileges for the citizens. The next fundamental rights objective is to establish political democracy, whereas dietary principles objective is to establish a welfare state. Okay, the next one, since they are concerned with the individual rights, their scope is limited. Okay, since the fundamental rights are concerned with the individual rights, that is why the scope is limited, whereas dietary principles, as you know, they deal with that wide range of subjects including international peace and security, their scope is wide. Did you understand? So this is a differences, or we can say a comparison being made between fundamental right and dietary principles of state policy. Okay, I hope you all have understood it. So my dear children, we have come to the end of this chapter also. So hopefully you all have understood it. If you have not understood it, please go through the video again, and if still you feel space problem, then you can call me. Okay, so what is mean by directive principles of state policy? Directive principles of state policies are the guidelines for the central government or the state government to include it while framing the policy. Those guidelines should be included while framing the policy. Okay, so it is mentioned down in part 4 of our term. Just remember three things: fundamental rights part 3, the directive principles part 4, okay, and fundamental duties part 4a. Why 4? And because directive principles of state policy was there from the beginning only, along with the fundamental right when constitution was enforced from that time, whereas fundamental duties were included later on through 42nd Amendment Act, okay, 1976, that time it was, that is why 4a. Okay children, so hopefully you all have understood it. So everything is there in our constitution, everything is there. What are the duties, what are the rights, what should be the duties of the state government, everything are mentioned over there. So if everyone follows it strictly, then definitely there won't be any problem in the